Craig and I are at the still site.
We have 15 gallons of a high-proof macerated base spirit.
Oh, yeah, it's green.
Ooh, it's strong. And we're going to run our white absinthe. We're going to put 55 gallons of water in here also. Oh, yeah.
Ready?
Come on. The downside of throwing all these botanicals in the pot is we can scorch the bottom of the pot.
That's it?
You got to stir it now. This ain't no crawfish pot. It's going to take a little while to get this heated up. It's going to start to roll on its own, and we don't have to worry about anything sticking. You got to make sure that you stir it so nothing settles at the bottom. And when this thing starts to boil, convection will kick in and it'll roll around. There's a lot of work doing that.
She's starting to steam good. She's starting to roll.
We're gonna go ahead and cap it, because right now it's ready to go. Make sure that's in there good. Now we're flowing good. Them heads gotta go. That's a nice drip she got right there. Once we throw the heads out, I get a chance to take the first taste of it. See what our brand new white absinthe tastes like.
See what this is all about. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Ooh, yeah. That sweet citrus flavor, man, that calmed that wormwood down.
Yeah, that lemon balm.
Mm-hmm. This tastes good. This is the absinthe that we were looking for. I could taste that the flavors are not crashing into each other, that they're layering, that they're marrying each other well. That's the stuff. That's what we could sell a customer right here. After we make it green, it's gonna make us some green. This is a customer in the big city, you know, and he really likes our liquor.
Is that a green absinthe?
That's green absinthe.
I hope that he asks us for some more, something more challenging than this. That way we could get our names out there, let people know we're capable of pretty much anything as far as liquor goes.
Now that we have our pot full of bananas, we're gonna start adding some water, light our burner, bring it to a boil.
You know what we gotta bring to the party now, though? Now we gotta chop up some sugar cane.
Oh, yeah.
We're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves. The thing about cane sugars are they're very, very, very sugary. They have a real high sucrose content to them. So we don't need a whole lot of this stuff, just enough clean sugar to bring a real true taste through.
Yeah, I think it's ready, man. Let's pour in and cool it down.
Just what we have right now as a base is awesome. We're starting out with a solid foundation.
You see this vanilla right here? It's gonna give a nice, pleasant flavor.
Just that little bit of vanilla you would think would not be enough to do anything. Well, sir, you would be sadly mistaken.
And a banana's foster dessert, it calls for nuts to be used. So we're gonna caramelize those today, and we're gonna add them into our spice rum, and we're gonna let them sit.
When this dessert was made at first in the 1950s in New Orleans, it was prepared with brown sugar, butter, cinnamon, banana liqueur, spice rum. It was flambéed tableside by a chef.
Man, that smells good.
We got 18 gallons of this macerated spicy rum going in right now. We're gonna add that to 50 gallons of water and our 35 gallons of mash. We have a maceration where we took our caramelized nuts and we put them into our spice rum that we ran initially. It should get the creamy texture of milk and should give us just what we need for our bananas foster. That's it. It's good too. It's what we've been waiting for. That's what we wanted. That's a relief. I mean, vanilla is definitely here now. Now this is a true bananas foster. Now we got a Bayou Buffet going on. Now we got a true Louisiana delicacy we just did.
We got fresh cherries, cane juice. We're making us some hillbilly Cajun cognac.
When you're dealing with fruits, it's very important to make sure you start to break down the structure so it can ferment effectively.
Yeah, they're getting mushy.
Dropping these pits out.
Look there, pit right there. When it comes to the stones, as they used to call the seed and the fruit, not only can they produce wood alcohol, which is a no-no, seeds also can contain cyanide. We eliminate that altogether just so that doesn't have to be a concern.
That's sugar cane juice right there.
If each of these buckets was equivalent to 50 pounds of sugar, I mean, we've got plenty. The more sugar, the more alcohol.
This is our spear run. This is where we're gonna get our flavor and everything else from.
It's gonna get hot quick.
It's hot right now.
That'd be pot holder.
Oh,
yeah. What's wrong with you?
It's coming. Oh, it's already.
I'm telling you, look.
You're a damn glutton for punishment.
That's how you make one start quick.
That's how you do it.
Now, there's what damn dreams is made of, buddy.
There's a jar out there, Hattie. Let's see where we're at. It ought to be really good liquor right about now.
There you go. I caught you a little bit. Look at here.
And it's pretty.
Mmm.
Man, it smells good.
Tastes off
good,
too.
It is good.
Fiery. It's a lot of tea, man. Now that we have this de-aging process, I want to do something that nobody's ever done before. So I want to do Mungli AT whiskey.
Oh, man, why you got to put so much?
Mungli is an herb that grows wild around here. It's good for respiratory ailments and infections.
I forgot how much hard work making moonshine is.
Yeah, but you're about to do it on another level today. We're going to have to make 2,000 gallons of a Mungli AT corn mash. We've never done anything like that before. We're going to fill up this pot. We're going to fill up these two tote tanks with mash. Every few days, we'll come in here, we'll do a mash, and we'll do a run.
You're talking about 2-3 weeks here.
Yeah, it's going to take a little while to do this, man. We yield about 25 gallons of run on our still. So we're going to have to make 10 runs on a 250-gallon submarine still.
Switching over.
We can't waste no time today. Very first thing we got to do is we got to make this tea base. Let's start breaking up some mungi, man. Basically, this is a corn run. We're not going to use water. We're going to use our Mungli AT. We can't just drop all that in there. But we're going to use this, Craig.
Oh, yeah, for the pots. I never thought of that.
Tell you what, we got some more of that screen material. We got to make a tea bag. We're going to roll this up. This is our key ingredient right here. So we want to make sure that this is really presented well within the drink. That's going to be more than enough. You see the color of this water already? Now we can get to work on the rest of it. I'm going to put these two colanders together. I'm going to make this like a tea steeper. You know, the little thing that, you know, it takes the tea and picks up the tea and you can put it in the hot water. Well, we made something like that with some colanders. If you make moonshine, you're going to have some good ideas in your head. Usually you make a mash in water, just clean water. We're going to use this Mungli AT as our water. Stir good, make sure it ain't gonna burn, and we gotta get some corn in that big pot. You cannot scorch this. If you do, it will carry over to your final product, and that's not something we wanna take the chance of doing. We're gonna drop a little bit malted barley. We don't wanna drop a lot, but I gotta kill a malted barley. Malted barley is the enzyme that we're gonna use to convert the starches that are within the corn to fermentable sugars. Now, Craig, I'm gonna drop some of that malted barley in on the big pot. You're gonna be tasked with the responsibility of stirring everything. You're gonna have to move fast.
Yeah, yeah, but you gotta get out of my way, though. This is just madness. We've never worked with this large volume before, and we're trying to watch 5 pots at one time. A still is just crazy.
I didn't think scaling up would be this much work. We can't let anything stick to this pot. It's just the volume that we had to put out. We're gonna bucket it out. We're gonna start dumping it in these toasts. Anything worth having is worth working for and waiting for it. Why don't you get a bag and do those other two over there?
Okay.
And this recipe calls for just that, working on it and waiting for it.
Hey, come here, man, it's running. This is the moment of truth.
Oh, when it starts running, I mean, I'm just anxious. I almost want to put my mouth underneath and start tasting it, man. Look how pretty that is.
Right, that's what I've been waiting for.
That's clear, clear.
All right, let's see. You know, it still smells so much like Mungli AT.
Yeah, it still smells like
it's like you want to see green in here. Yeah, but I smell a lot of corn liquor, too.
It's exactly 1:30. This is the first Mungli AT corn moonshine ever made in the world.
And ever tasted.
Let's see.
It's pretty damn smooth.
Oh, goddamn, that's good. I can't believe we pulled this off. This is a real good whiskey. Aging this is only gonna do it better. That warmed me down all the way to my stomach.
I know, it's still warming me right now.
Man, we finally get to enjoy this damn liquor. I mean, and it's good. So I'm looking forward now to doing all of this work. The first 5 gallons going in.
First of many here.
Yep, we gotta do this 40 times. We'll keep this process going until we fill all 4 of those barrels. It's gonna be worth it though, because it's a really good drink. We're doing it big. We can make some money with this.